Welcome back. In this video, we will address the principles of operation of fault current sources and fault current limiters, two important devices for the protection of microgrids. In detail, we will learn what is a fault current source and when should it be installed. We will also look at fault current limiters, at how they work, and at the advantages and disadvantages. As we have previously seen, short circuit currents are relatively low in microgrids. This can affect the fault current sensitivity. One of the solutions for that problem is to connect a fault current source. A fault current source is used to increase the fault current levels. A battery connected through a power converter or a flywheel can be used as a fault current source. During a typical fault condition, four stages in the voltage waveform can be identified. First, before the voltage magnitude is close to its nominal value. Second, during the fault, the voltage drops to a certain lower value. Third, during the fault current source increases the fault current, and as a result, the voltage increases, but still without reaching its nominal value. Finally, the fourth stage, when the fault location is isolated, the voltage magnitude goes back to its original value. Let us now look at an example showing the behavior of a fault current source during the fault. Before the fault, the voltage at the terminal of the fault current source is equal to the nominal voltage value, and its current is zero. When the fault occurs at t equals 0 seconds, the fault current source immediately increases its current. As a result, the voltage increases and the fault is detected. Around t equals 250 milliseconds, the fault is cleared. The fault current source then stops its current injection, and the voltage and its terminals goes back to its original value. Even though low fault currents was mentioned to be one of the main challenges in microgrid protection, in some fault cases the current reaches very high values and its limitation. This is when several distributed generators, such as synchronous machines with high fault currents, contribute to raise the fault current level beyond the design limits. This could result in damage to personnel and equipment. To mitigate the negative impact of high fault currents, fault current limiters are installed to limit the current in case of faults. As we can see, the fault current limiter is responsible for suppressing the large fault current after the fault. A fault current limiter can be implemented in many different ways, such as a fuse installed in a machine. Fault current limitation can be implemented in both passive and active manners. Passive solutions act both for normal and fault operations, while active solutions are only applied during fault conditions. Passive solutions are based on having equipment with an increased current path impedance at both nominal and fault conditions. Transformers with increased short circuit impedance are an example of passive fault current limiters. A disadvantage of this solution is that the increased impedance generates losses and a voltage drop during the normal operation. Active solutions have a nonlinear behavior that allows them to quickly increase their impedance during a fault. The disadvantage of this solution is that it requires the replacement of the devices after a fault, like in the case of the fuses, and the setting of relays must be well adjusted to ensure good selectivity. In the figure, we can see a fault current limiter that is operated through three different paths, A, B, and C. During normal operation, the mechanical switch is closed. When the fault occurs, the fast mechanical switch is disconnected, forcing the fault current to flow through the resistor in path B. The fault current is then limited to the addition of the resistor. After the fault is cleared, the gate turn-off thyristor GTO bridge can be used to bypass the resistor after the fault. To sum up, in this video, we have seen that fault current sources are implemented in microgrids to increase the fault current levels, hence improving sensitivity. We also saw the four stages in the voltage waveform during a fault at which the fault current source is triggered. Finally, we learned that in some cases, a fault current limiter is needed to suppress a large fault current and prevent damages from happening. Fault current limiters are classified as either passive or active solutions. Passive solutions have the advantage of always being operational, but generate losses due to their high impedance, Whereas active solutions are more efficient and act only during faults. They need to be replaced after a fault.